I'm Riccardo Bruno from NFN in Catania and currently working for the INDIGO DataCloud project. This presentation is about the Future Gateway and the points that will be covered during this presentation are, of course, an introduction of the Future Gateway system, how it is implemented in the context of the INDIGO DataCloud project. Some words will be spent on how this system is managing the authentication and authorization. And then I will show you some of the APIs provided by this system. A few words will be spent also for the installation and if the time is enough to continue, I will introduce also the database structure of the Future Gateway. So let's start with to introduce you on the Future Gateway. Shortly, the Future Gateway is a framework aiming to build science gateways. So maybe many of you have already an idea of what Science Gateway is, but I like to show definition that has been written by the TerraGrid XL project, where it says a Science Gateway is a community developed set of tools, applications, and data integrated via portal or a suite of applications, usually in a user interface, and further customized to meet the needs of a specific community. So I like this definition because it highlights some of the important points of a Science Gateway. And those points are the community. So it must be a system aiming the community to work and cooperate each other. We have the presence of tools, applications, and data, and the integration of those. It provides a graphical user interface. So it is important to provide to the users web interface or desktop applications or mobile even. And then the word customization, I would say the most important one, because by the experience, we noticed that any community has its own tools, has its own web portal, and it is important for existing communities to provide the customizable things. As I told you, the Future Gateway is not starting from zero. It's an evolution of another product that we called in the past the Catania Science Gateway Framework, aiming still to create the science gateways. So let's see some of the design principles. So the first point at the Future Gateway provides, as most as possible, an easy way to install it and also maintain in the time the system. So we have installation scripts at the moment. We are planning to have also Ansible roles for cloud environments, and also in the future, we hope to have also Docker container installation. All the source codes are available on GitHub, and the software design itself is thought to be highly customizable, just to allow different communities to satisfy their needs. It provides, as a second point, a flexible and uniform access to distributed computing services. What does means? Under the hood, the Future Gateway is using the so-called JSAGA library. That is a library aiming to access with a single set of function calls to interact with the grid and also cloud infrastructures. In the context of the INDIGO DataCloud project, besides the JSAGA, we are also providing the access to the Tosca orchestrator. That is a system that helps to create on-demand platform as a service infrastructures in a dynamic way. And the third point, the most important one, is that the Future Gateway provides a set of API calls in the RESTful format. So this is an important point because with the use of REST APIs, it's possible to have to reach the portal independency. So any community can use its own portal technology. It is possible also to deal with mobile and desktop applications. And RESTful APIs can be also used by any programming language. So in this, with the use of RESTful APIs, we are targeting the customizable thing I told you during the description of the Future Gateway. Some important concepts in the Future Gateway. This system is managing three entities. On the top, we have applications. So something that will be performed on the distributed computing infrastructure. The second component is the infrastructure itself. The infrastructure is a description of the distributed computing infrastructure. I mean, a cloud infrastructure, a grid infrastructure. And so with the infrastructure, I'm describing which is the security mechanism used in this infrastructure, how the application will run on this infrastructure, etc. The task is the third entity, is the instance of an application. I mean, we used the word task instead of saying jobs as it happens on the grid environment, because with the Future Gateway, we can application can be many possible things. A task could be a simple batch execution running on a cluster, or a task could be also a job that runs on a virtual machine started automatically, or in the case of the platform as a service with INDIGO, with the term of task, I could mean that I create several nodes and those nodes will start a batch execution. So the API provided by the Future Gateway are written in their specification are available on the Future Gateway API website. We are using a web tool to describe the APIs, and we are using API. And as I told you, the APIs are managing exactly the three entities I described before. So the tasks, the applications, and the infrastructures. And we will see later how the APIs will manage those entities. By this slide, we can see some of the usage scenario that the Future Gateway framework can offer. So on top of the slide, we have the final users or final users using mobile and desktop application. Below, on the left side, we have the life a scenario like the Catania Science Gateway framework. That means we have a Liferay portal and several portlets inside, providing a GUI for some applications, and below the API server provided by the Future Gateway. So this is exactly the so this scenario on the left provides exactly the same scenario of the Catania Science Gateway framework. On the middle, we have an existing community portal, and you can develop on it portlets or web applications. Let's imagine Tomcat with its own web applications, or you can even use flat web technology and with Ajax to provide queries to call APIs provided by the Future Gateway. So in this context, the Future Gateway is an external component, and the community portal communicate with the API server, and the API server will interact with the distributed computing infrastructure. In the case of a mobile and desktop application, the connection could be a direct connection, but in the phase of authentication and authorization, you need a service named PTV. And I will show you later. I will give you information about this service later, so you will understand better what happens during the authentication and the authorization phase. So the Future Gateway is composed by three elements. We have, on top of all, a database that keeps and maintains during its lifetime the information about executed tasks, installed applications, which are the infrastructure used by the application. Then it manages a queue of tasks, and we will see later how. And finally, it manages users, groups, and roles. The second component is the API server frontend, which accepts APIs, the calls provided by the users, fills a queue table that corresponds to the command. It also is responsible to manage the authorization and authentication. It is responsible also to manage application tasks and infrastructure. And in this scenario, more front ends could exist. So at the moment, in the context of the Future Gateway framework, there exists only one front end named FG API server. Maybe this is wrong, sorry. No, so it's like, okay, FG API server. This is the front end. The third point, the third element is the API server only. And this is extracting the tasks written in the queue and execute the command described in the task. It also check the consistency of the submitted tasks timely. And it is also responsible to retrieve the output if the executed task produced any. So in the architecture design, you may have also more API server. This too could be possible for different reasons, from scalability, for instance, or to reach other distributed computing infrastructures. This is a very simple schema. On top, we have the GUIs. Then we have a layer, the green layer, with the API, the possible API frontends that are communicating with the database. And below, we have the API servers that are extracting from the command queue the tasks. And the tasks are executed on the DCIs that are in the little cloud below, in the bottom of the figure. So let's see the API frontend part. So on the left side, we have a graphical user interface that through the REST APIs is sending a command. So from we are starting from the left to the right. This command is taken by the front-end, and the front-end first verify the authentication and the authorization, so it produces a check. This check could be also done with the external AAI system. Then the if the authentication is successful, the process the command is processed, and you could provide immediately a response, or if you need to update the database, you change the database accordingly. And in case of a task management, you could enqueue the command on the queue table and create the response. So the command and the response are both in a JSON stream format. On the other side, we have the API server. The API server, as I told you, is extracting the commands from the queue. And inside each command, there are two elements. There is the action. So what you are going to do with on the DCI, and another a name that corresponds to the so-called executor interface. That means the element that the API server will use to physically interact with the distributed computing infrastructure. So at the moment, in the context of INDIGO DataCloud project, there are only two executor interfaces available. The first is called the Grid Engine. It's a small component, a core component of the Catania Sci-GaIA framework that is using JSAGA to target SSH connections. So let's imagine the access to clusters. It also provides Aereo CCI, so you can instantiate a virtual machine dynamically and execute an application inside this machine, and the classic grid usage with the WMS. With INDIGO, we are using Tosca Orchestrator, and I told you the meaning of this component is to create platform as a services, and then also give the possibility to run, to execute something on those platforms. So let's have a look on the implementation of the FutureGateway framework has been implemented with the INDIGO context. So on top of the figure, we have the graphic user interfaces available, so web, mobile, and potentially desktop application, but in the case of FutureGateway, also the INDIGO DataCloud project, there are no desktop applications. On the left, we have the FGIBI server database, and the first two components, the other second components that are the front end that are taking the REST APIs from the GUI, and the API server that are extracting the tasks from the queue table. The API server is, depending on the kind of task to execute, will call the right executor interface. So, for instance, on the left, the Grid and Cloud Engine. The Grid and Cloud Engine will interact with JSAGA. JSAGA provides a mechanism of adapters, and dependingly on if you want an SSH connection or a grid execution or a cloud, you can then interact physically with the distributed computing infrastructures. If the executor interface is the Tosca, With the Tosca, you can directly connect with the Tosca orchestrator, and the Tosca orchestrator will send the request to the distributed computing infrastructure. So for INDIGO-DataCloud of the front end is available on Git. You can find the web address of the source code. This this code is written in Python, and it uses the Flask microframework. And this software implements the API as they are described in the specification site. And this service can run in two modes. The first is a standalone mode, and that means you execute Python and the name of the main file. And this is can be satisfactory only for testing purposes or development environment. But in production, it is suggested that you configure WSGI on your web platform. And we can support you for Apache and Mu WSGI with Nginx. This implementation of the front end is using the MySQL as database, and as I told you, the database is managing the tasks, application infrastructure, user group and roles, and the task queue. The API server daemon is the other component, is available on Git. It's a servlet this time, and it is running on top of Tomcat application server. It's simply a Java application that it's a web application that execute it execute a process that polls the queue table. The choice to write a Java application, a Java web application, is because we needed to interact with the JSAGA JSAGA libraries, and JSAGA is available only in Java. The daemon is extracting the tasks from the queue. It discover which is the executor interface for the execution, and calls with the name of the executor interface the proper class, and the class finally will do the interaction with the distributed computing infrastructure. It also provides a timely check in order to see if the executed task terminated or not, and eventually retrieve the output if it exists. Otherwise, it also prompts for errors, etc. The API server daemon provides also a control panel. In the slides shows that this component is not yet consolidated. No developments have been done since the creation, but the aim of this control panel is to provide and eventually in the future configure the behavior of the daemon part of the future gateway. So let's start now to see how the Future Gateway is currently managing authentication and authorization. So we have basically three methods to manage authentication and authorization. We have the so-called baseline mode. That is a very simple approach. It is very close to how OAuth is working. And we provide this kind of authorization and authentication mechanism for all those environments where there is no AI implemented at all. So communities that don't have this system can use the baseline or can customize the baseline. Customize means that the code has been written in the way that you could change or just one function to have the customization done. Then we have the way that the old platform was using, the Catania Science Gateway framework way, with it is using Shibboleth. The portal is managing the responsibility to manage the authentication and authorization is delivered to the portal. The portal must implement the so-called PTV service, Portal Token Validation, means the acronym. We will see what kind of service provides this PTV. And what happens is that the portal users are mapped with a mechanism with the Future Gateway API users. So you should, in this way, you have the portal users and the Future Gateway API users, and you have to find a way to map those two different kind of users. And finally, we have the IndigoDC IAM way that use in Indigo. We have a special case where we are using AI. IAM. It's another system that use OAuth, and also in this case, it's the portal that manages the authentication and authorization. It still uses the portal token validation service, and again, portal users are mapped somehow with the API users. In the case of mobile and desktop application, again, we should use the PTV service to contacting first the portal and then the API server. I think better to see a figure. And this is explaining the case of the baseline authentication and authorization. Step number one, the user contacts a login service, providing a username and password. And this information will be encrypted with a key. The key contains, this information is encrypted with the information of the username, the password, and the timestamp, and collected in the log token. The log token is then used to start to access to use the API server. So there exists a special REST call for this. You provide this log token. The log token is taken, decrypted using the same key used during the encryption. And with this mechanism, you can identify the user stored on the API server. If the user exists and the timestamp is okay, and this API call of the token check will create as another token that is called the session token. We are at the point number three. The session point will be used later for any other API call. So if I want to get the list of the task, if I want to submit the task, etc. You are free to use this session token until the token expiration, because it has a limited lifetime. In Catania Science Gateway case, we have a user on the left that contacts to a portal. The portal provides, redirects any user request to a identity provider service that provides the authentication of the user. Once the user is authenticated, another system is providing the authorization with the LDAP. The user is authenticated and also authorized, will be produced a token in the step three. This token, each time a REST call is is provided to the API server frontend, a call to the portal token validation service will given, and this the aim of this call is to check the validity of the token. If the token is valid, the API server can process the request. During the Catania Science Gateway framework, we were accessing the resources using the eToken server service. This is a service that creates robot proxies needed for all those infrastructure using the GSI security mechanism, the grid security infrastructure. In the case of Indigo, the service, the system seems similar. We have the so-called IAM service that provides both authentication and authorization, and it replies during the login phase with the portal with a token. This token is also used to access the API calls, and again, each incoming token will be checked with the portal token validation service. And if the token is okay, the API server will process the request and bypass the token to the resources. So EM tokens are also used to access Indigo resources. But let's see now what is exactly the portal token validation service. A service normally provided by the portal. And the aiming is really simple. It just verifies or get fresh tokens. In order to contact the portal token validation, you need to configure the HTTP basic authentication method. And just encrypting the username and password with a base64 and placing it in the header of the request. And those settings are configurable parameters in the configuration of the API server frontend. So the services are verify an incoming token or get a new fresh token. So in the case of verify, you have to provide a post request providing the token on the token parameter. If the token is okay, so you receive a successful answer, and you also receive the field subject that identify uniquely the user associated to that token. In order to get a new token, you have to create a post request specifying just the subject. And as a result, you will receive a successful token, a new fresh token. In the case of Indigo project, the PTV service is provided in the form of Liferay EM. It's a service developed on top of Liferay 7. So in those cases, you could recycle this. But we have other use cases where the PTV is has been implemented from scratch. And there is one of the use cases is molecular dynamics is implementing it in Python. So soon their source code will be available as well. So the implementation of the Future Gateway so far are at the beginning of the Indigo project was published the demonstrator, and the Molecular Dynamic project was presented during CloudScape in February 2016. Then during the first review of the project, some interesting use cases were presented for climate change, showing how the Ophidia system, that is a kind of architecture to compute on big data sets, And Kepler is another system to manage workflows. So this system was integrated with the FutureGateway to execute using the APIs. And also another use case is using Galaxy, is another workflow management system integrated again with the FutureGateway. And in this case, they are also providing some interfaces with mobile applications. So let's start to view the APIs. So the main aim of the FutureGateway APIs is the task management. So as I told you, the word task is a generic word that can imply the running of a job, deploy a virtual machine, or instantiate a platform as a service, execute a job inside the virtual machine, a machine, etc. It could also also a data activity can be included in a task format. So the API manages the task entities in the form of the task that is an instance of a described application. Infrastructure is the way where the application can run, and then the management of user groups and roles. So the logic, so the tasks are a task application instance. Application define an executable or an infrastructure. An application may need input and output files or create output files. So you must have a way to describe those entities. Application also accept arguments, and at the end, when you describe an application, you need to describe where this application can run in the form of the infrastructure. Infrastructure is a set of key value pairs that are used by the executor interface to finally interact with the distributed computing infrastructure. In the case of JSAGA, for instance, you are defining some input parameters needed by the JSAGA adapters. In the case of the Grid and Cloud Engine, we are also providing information to address the eToken server parameters. So the way the system can generate a robot proxy on behalf of the user. So in the case of Indigo, we have configurable parameters to manage the task orchestrator. Maybe later there is an example if we have enough time to reach that part. So the information about the users, group, and roles, we have that roles, so what the user can do, are assigned to a set of groups. The users are finally assigned to groups. So in this way, you can assign to the users certain privilege or deny other. So each time an API call is received during the first check, it is also controlled that the a user can execute the API, the specific API call or not. So during the API description, I will use some convention. I'm using the curl command to explain the APIs. Curl is a well-known command. It's also very helpful during test and development phases. In the examples provided, I'm not including the tokens, just for to be more clear in the explanation. But for the token management, what you have to do is simply including the token information in the EtHER section of the request. During your own tests and development, I recommend to the use of the GQ command line tool. If you don't have it, you can install easily in any operating system. GQ produces a JSON output format in a human readable way. So you can see colorized the field parameters and so on. You can even use other tools to execute APIs. There exists also Postman as a graphical user interface, a web graphical user interface to do exactly the same things of query. So this is on top, you can see a typical curl execution. So we have curl minus h specifying any parameter in the either section of your request. Optionally, you can provide some curl options for verbosity, for instance. Then, with the minus x capital, you can specify which HTTP method you are going to call. This method could be get, post, patch, or delete. Then the address of the API you want the API, so the Future Gateway host, Future Gateway port, the version of the API you are going to use, and then the action and optionally some filter parameters. Input and outputs are in JSON format. The output contains also a special field named underscore links that helps the user to or even the GUI to automatically generate possible answers. And okay, the basic line AI use tokens. Okay, and for instance, at the bottom of the slide, you can see how okay, you can specify, for instance, a token during the execution. So minus minus capital H, then authentication colon bearer, and then your token. This is the way that the API server uses to send the token. In the API call, you can also use filters. Sometimes, for instance, to get the list of tasks of users. And well, with the user filter, you can impersonate even other users, depending if you have this role or not in your roles. So, for instance, when you are listing all applications or tasks, if you specify user equal to star, you are going to see the tasks of any user in the system. Or if you would like to see the tasks of a particular group of users, you can even use the monkey character. So you can limit the visibility of the API call just to a single group. In order to use this filter, you need special parameters, special roles, and those are the user impersonate and group impersonate. Normally, if not specifying a user in the APIs, a user in the filter, I mean, the API server will use a default user. Otherwise, it tries from the token to extract the user information, and the visibility will be from the user owning the token. Let's see the first example, how to list all the tasks. So just execute the curl. HTTP, specify the host, the port, the version, and then tasks. And this replies with a JSON containing under the keyword task an array with the several task records. So you can see the internal ID number, then which is the user, the status of the task, the description, date, which are the input files, the output files, which is the application identifier linked to this task, and so on. This call could be used, for instance, just to get the status information. So during after the execution of a task, you can check status with this call. So in this way, you are retrieving all the tasks. But if you want to filter out the answer, you can restrict, for instance, the answer to a limited to just one user. So if you use the filter user equal to and specify the users, and then you can use also the wildcards like star or at for groups or for all users. If you want to restrict also the answer to an user and an application, you can also use the filters as you can see in the second step. So you are specifying the username and also the application ID. You can also see the status, the information of a specific task, providing the curl command, HTTP, host port, the version number, tasks, and then the task identifier. In this case, you receive just a task record containing again the same structure, so the identification number of the task, the user who created the task, the status of this task, and so on. How to submit a task? In order to submit a task, you need to provide a curl command executing a post action, and the data of this post action are simple JSON structure, a JSON stream containing the application identifier and the description of your execution. This is depending on how the application is has been created. This is the minimal set of information you can provide to execute something on a DCI. Of course, in the real world, you can also add other information like input files, where to get the input files, where do you, which output file you will receive, etc. But what happens when you submit a task? There are two possibilities. The job, the task is executed immediately, or the task is waiting for further input files. So this is depending on how the application has been configured, because you can specify default files. If you specify those default files, there is a case where the execution can start immediately. Otherwise, the task waits that you provide the input files for the application execution. How do you provide those files? There is this input REST call that again is a post action. The endpoint is the task ID and then input. So in this case, you are just accepting the default output input files. Otherwise, in the second curl call, you are uploading the file needed to execute that application. So the task will start. It will finish after a while, and in the task information, as soon as the status of the task is done, you will find inside the output files the URL to access on the content of this the output files. So, for instance, you can in this slide, I'm underlying the file path. And if you cut and paste this path to curl command, so HTTP, localhost, 8.8.8, and the version of the API, and then on the wall output of the field URL, you can access to the file. To delete a task, you have to provide a minus x delete as an action and specifying just the tasks and the point, and then specifying which is the task that you want to remove. This method is high is very removes totally any information about this task from the database. So the use of delete should be done only by administrators. Another feature of the task management is the runtime data. So it's done through a patch method, and with the runtime data, you have the possibility to communicate or I would say to save data produced by the task in form of record. So the runtime data is an array containing the data coming from the task, and this data is customizable from the application. And the fields are the data name, the name of the data that you want to save, which is the value, and the description of this value. To understand this, you may think about running application on an infrastructure that produce the percentage of its execution. So you can publish this data using runtime data. So in the status, when you get the status of this task, you are updated also with a fresh information about the execution in percentage value of the task. One of the latest feature was also to introduce the canceled status. So the user can change the status of a task. You can ask canceled in order to remove the task from the execution. This completes the task part of the API. Then we can see the part related to application management in a very similar way in order to get the list of all applications. You have the endpoint applications. If you want to restrict the list of the application to a particular application identifier, you can get the single record with the application and then specify its identity number. To install an application, you need to specify a post action. The data related to this post action is again in JSON format. You can see here an example. We are requesting, we are creating an application that creates a job. So you see, outcome is a job and it's not an infrastructure. A description of this application, the name, if this application is enabled, and the parameters used by this application. And inside the parameters, we have the description, for instance, which is the target executor, which is the executable, etc. And then the infrastructure section, where you specify the infrastructures. Some nodes You have seen that I'm specifying in the example infrastructure inside the application creation. This is still acceptable, but from the newest version developed recently, you can also specify infrastructure IDs, identifiers. Here you are some details about this implementation, but I think we don't have enough time to go here, but maybe later. I prefer to go directly to the infrastructure management first. In the same way, you can manage infrastructures used by the application to list them. So I want to see infrastructure and then specify the infrastructure ID, or without specifying the infrastructure ID, I can show all infrastructures. I can install a new infrastructure using executing a post action. So here is an example of a very simple infrastructure with the simplest tool. Example they can provide, specifying an SSH access. And in the same way, we have with the delete method the way to delete an infrastructure. So about the API usage, some consideration can be provided. The normally APIs can produced in a web page through the use of AJAX or in other format with Liferay portlets, with all the Liferay 6.2. In the Liferay 7, we are still using AJAX. The use of REST API opens to many programming languages and also web architectures. And okay, in case to access infrastructure using the X509 proxy certificate. In the past, we helped the developers to access our infrastructure with VPN access or to provide a way to access our EthERNet service. This is an example of AJAX call. So you prepare the URL of the API call under the URL field. You are specifying a post action. This is an example of task execution. And you can see this example inside the hello tester, inside the specified Git address. Here are some consideration about the creation of Liferay portlets in the context of Liferay 6.2. So you have the several steps described how you get started with portlet development. In Liferay 7, the environment has changed. So there is another way to create portlets. You are using a single executable named the blade, and there is also a link to the documentation of this new way to create portlets for Liferay 7. So on the other side, we are also starting to think in creating some libraries for the most popular languages, Java, Python, and PHP. For creating high-level classes that are hiding the APIs. So maybe this could be also useful for developers, especially for those using desktop and mobile applications. And finally, we are in the installation of the Future Gateway. The installation the everything you need for installing the Future Gateway is available on Git, and here you are a Git address. Maybe I will change this slide because it's not the Indigo link, but the link works as well. There are the installation scripts are split in two different kinds of typology. We have core scripts, and those are the one starting with setup underscore something. And one of these files is one of the most important one because it's the setup config. This file is containing any configurable value that you can customize during the installation. Then during the installation, some files are needed. They are containing libraries and other static content. And the installation can be done on top of Ubuntu 14.04. You have the name of the installation files. And there exists also the installation on top of CentOS 7, if I'm not wrong. And it is not reported in the slide. So maybe I will modify also this. It is also possible to install the FutureGateway on top of the AGI Fed Cloud. I don't know if the AGI Fed Cloud has been described before, but shortly the Fed Cloud is an environment where registered the user can deploy virtual machine on demand. So without caring where they are running or not. So you just access to a virtual machine from everywhere. So to install, here in this slide you have instruction to install the Future Gateway on top of Ubuntu. So the first step is to extract from Git the setup file. Then there is a moment where you need to configure inside the FG setup file, there is a place where you can specify some configurable settings, and then to execute the script, just execute FG setup with the username FutureGateway, hostname FutureGateway, the SSH port that is configured on that host, and the public key that you want to use. I think it's much more complicated to say in via slides, but if you, for instance, go on the GitHub page and have a look on the README, everything is much more clear. The same script is also usable on a Docker container. So if you, for this reason, a specific script has been written as well. So you can start a Docker container, and executing that script on a Docker container, you will get also a future gateway. Here you are instruction on how to install the future gateway using the AG Fed Cloud. You need to be registered to a virtual organization. You need a personal certificate, also a command line tool provided by the AGI Fed Cloud. And once you you get all those things, then you can go to the virtual appliance. So that is the a virtual machine available for this. And you can execute this virtual machine, and this automatically installs the Future Gateway. This is performed thanks to the contextualization scripts. A contextualization script is available for the Future Gateway. And in this slide, I'm highlighting some of the important points of this contextualization script, because you need to customize this contextualization script for your purposes. For instance, you can change your SSH key. So you can provide, you have to modify this field. And you can also change the SSH port where the system will be available. You can change passwords for Tomcat or ask for a lifeline installation or not, or if you want to reboot the machine after the installation and so on. You can even customize other parameters. This is well depicted in the README of the GitHub place describing the contextualization file. And this is exactly in this slide, you have the instruction on how to customize specific settings that are contained in the setup config. So once the installation finishes, the installation creates also the Future Gateway service. It is available under etc.init.d, and you can manage its execution with the Future Gateway start, stop, restart, etc. There are also several considerations if you are configured the API server front-end using WSGI. In this case, you have to switch a flag accordingly. How to monitor the execution of the Future Gateway? If the standalone, if the front end is running a standalone mode, there exists a screen section. You can go attached to this screen section. You have details about this activity. For the API server daemon, it is running with Tomcat. So you can, for instance, access to the Catalina out logs, or for the specific daemon logs, you can go to the specified path Catalina home, web apps, web api server daemon, web inf logs, and api server daemon.log. And last point is explaining how to access to the API server database. There is the MySQL string able to connect to the DB. The installation also installs some shortcuts to connect to the database. The one is the ASDB, API Server Database, and the other one is the User Tracking Database, UTDB. And those are shortcuts just to don't write the long sequence of MySQL, minus H, etc., etc. They are connecting and shortcutting the first line. You can also provide an input to this ASDB, for instance, providing an SQL command. And this SQL command will be executed against the AP server database. The second user tracking DB, the UTDB, is another database that is used by the grid engine executor interface. So after you are using the automatic procedure to install the Future Gateway, you can test it immediately, because the system is installed in a way that you can perform some tests. So the first test is the Hello World example. In the slide, you have step-by-step how to do this. So I would like to move to the second example. Hello World, I would say that it's really as its name says, it's just an example, very limited. It's just execute on the same machine something. And the second example is a little bit more complex because it provides the classic usage of the classic scenario of a job execution on a remote machine. This example, you have argument for the application, you have also input files, output files, etc. So in this slide, you have again examples on how to perform by your own the test on the installed machine with this example. So hello world and say hello are tests that you can perform after the installation. So normally applications are stored on the front-end source code and under the apps folder. So you can find hello world and say hello in this directory. On Git, there exist other applications that you may see or try to configure for your own needs. And they are working in the same fashion. There is a script named setup underscore app that is the responsible to install the application using the API on the infrastructure. And then a call another script named stress test that execute the application on the infrastructure. Then you can collect in this app folder other files that are related to the application input files. Below, from now on, we will see some configurable fields from, for instance, in this case, the API server frontend. There is also the description of some of the fields. For instance, at the bottom you have the endpoint for the PTB. It's not the endpoint; it's the mapping file. Okay. But you can set up different values of this service. Okay. The endpoint is the last fifth row, for instance, the PTB endpoint, which is the PTB host name, password, etc. And then the second section of the front-end configuration is the related to the database. So you are specifying how to connect to the database. It could be in the same machine, but it could be also in another machine. If you are interested on configure the execution of the front-end with WSGI, here you are an example that you can try to use for your case. On the daemon part, the API server daemon stores several configurable parameters in a specific property file, API server daemon.properties, and this is containing several settings. The most important one are the one related to the polling, the queue of task polling. You have, for instance, max number of threads. The close timeout is used when you shut down the daemon. The delay of the polling. So, for instance, 4 seconds for each polling on the task queue. Then the maximum number of tasks to get from the queue for loop and the other fields. For instance, at the bottom we have the fields needed by the grid cloud engine to access the grid to its own database. So very simple, in order to maintain the future gateway in time and maintain it updated with the latest changes applied on the code, there exists also a possibility to keep the database updated during the time. How to do this, there is under the front-end code directories, there is the directory named dbpages. This directory contains another script named patch apply And if you execute it, it will check if a new version are available, if you database schema version are available, and in case applies the patches. Of course, this is a very it's the user must be very careful executing this kind of action, and it is highly suggested to verify the log files produced during this action. By the way, this mechanism allows to database schema and accordingly it's the code of the future gateway during its lifetime. To update the code, it is enough to update to check out from the GitHub the new source codes. Okay, these, for instance, are the instructions in this slide on how to update the system from a source code point of view. So go to the directory, eventually to the adapters directory, extract the new code with the Git pull, and in case you are updating the Java component, I mean the API server daemon, you have to compile again the application file, and the produced word file must be placed in the Catalina web apps application, and then it's suggested to check the log files for errors or if everything is fine. In the same way, the adapter are working. In case you are updating adapters, you have to first update the adapters and then copy the produced library inside the API server daemon, the library directory, and then recompile the API server daemon.